is beginning to rain, 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 in the voice of our Father. Saying, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas.
Well, hello, dear friends. Glad to be with you here at Bible Home Church. Right now, while I'm recording from our studio, which is a little ways from there, we're looking out. I see three deer eating bird seed. Why are they eating bird seed? Well, that's a different story, I suppose. We put out bird seed for the birds, and then the deer seem to enjoy it a lot. I don't know why they would, but in any case, they really enjoy it. And sometimes we've seen five or six deer out there at once, along with an assorted skunk and many squirrels and such, which our cat loves to chase. But it's wonderful to be out here near nature. You know, today we're going to be talking about how you can enter a state of nature with God. Isn't that interesting? You say, well, I don't want to do that. I'm a city person. Well, that's okay. It doesn't really matter. You can be hemmed in on all four sides with concrete and bricks. But did you know you can still be in a state of nature with God? And more than that, we're going to talk today about how God thinks. Now, that may seem very presumptuous of me to tell you that we're going to look at what God thinks or how he thinks, but I think there's a key to my doing so. You see, I just use the scriptures. In fact, in the first chapter of Genesis, my good friend Bob Treves, who puts out a publication called the Cherith Chronicles, sent me his publication this month, and you know, began to read that, and he always has some good ideas in that. But one of his thoughts was very significant, and I'm going to sort of amplify on what he talked about today, about how we can discern the mind of God. Now, a lot of people, can you imagine? I mean, there are people that should be willing to give everything they own just to understand how God thinks. You know, it can change your life dramatically. And certainly for the better, to know how God thinks. You know, I know how I think sometimes, and it just gets confusing and goes this way and that way and weird. And, you know, if I don't get in line with God, I can just get all messed up. Well, we're going to be talking about how you can line up your thoughts with God, but you have to understand some basic concepts. And in the short time we have here today, we're going to sort of start looking at that. And I think you're going to sort of, you're really going to enjoy it. Who wouldn't want to know how God thinks? He doesn't think like you and me, so how does he think? We're going to see just the way God works, his mind. And I love it because all I want is just a little bit of understanding of how God's mind works. And man, that would amplify my strength, my mental agility. I mean, I wouldn't be caught up in emotions. I wouldn't be a slave to mental manipulation by society if I could just know how God thinks. And I'd grab onto that. Wouldn't you, my friends? Can you imagine? Well, a lot of you like to write to me and tell me that you enjoy the message. Don't you? You don't? Well, write to me anyway, even if you did not enjoy the message. I'd love to hear from you. And, of course, as always mentioned, if you feel led by the Holy Ghost to give to this ministry so we can contribute to God's Word going around the globe, we would love to have a love gift from you. But it's not mandatory. Of course, it's not. Our program is free. Well, here we go with some music now. This is from the Gaither Gospel Series, God Gave the Song album. It's entitled, I Just Feel Like Something Good is About to Happen. And it's sung by Terry Blackwood, Stephen Hill, and Lady Love Smith.
Just to praise Him, for I know He's working all things for my good. Every tear I shed is worth all the investment, for I know He'll see me through, He said He would.
He has promised honor, ears, and heart to fathom all the things He has in store for those who pray.
I just feel like something good is about to happen. It's just about to happen. And brother, this could be that very day. I just feel like something good is just about to happen. And brother, this could be. Sister, this could be. Brother,
well, I want to thank the Gaither group for their wonderful album and that song. I'm Pastor Tex Mars of Bible Home Church. Today, we're going to be looking at an area that I think is so fascinating, the mind of God. Now, of course, you cannot possibly fathom the entire mind of God. It'd probably blow our brains apart to even imagine that we could. We simply don't have the capacity to have all of the intelligence. We don't have that capability. But listen, there are some principles that are vital that God has told us. Now, I think those who don't know Jesus Christ as Lord are going to be mixed up. They're not even going to understand what I'm saying today. But if you know Christ as Lord, you're going to really appreciate what I have to say. If you'll turn with me, my friends, to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, we start right at the beginning. See, God wants you to know a little bit of how His mind thinks. How He patterns matter, let's just say, since you and I are matter and we're spirit. And in what I'm going to tell you today, I'm going to tell you how you can be a free person. You can have freedom. Freedom. I'm going to show you how, if you can understand the mind of God, you will have freedom and liberty, and your soul will be at rest. That's an amazing thing, isn't it, my friends? Okay, we begin with reading verse 1. It says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." Okay, first of all, let's just stop there. In the beginning, God. Not in the beginning, there was some rock up in space that blew up, the Big Bang Theory. I'm not going to get in all that evolution junk. In the beginning, God. The first principle, the only one that counts, is God. Man wasn't here. The planet that we see today was not here. The animals weren't here. The plants were not here. And you and I were not here, nor were our ancestors, of course. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. He created it. It was out of nothing. Verse 2 says, "And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." Friends, listen very carefully. I believe that everybody is created by God. And at the beginning, you're without form, and you're void, and you're dark. You understand that? You're born in darkness. You're born, really, you're not fully formed. And you can stay that juvenile, unformed creature for all your life. In fact, for all of eternity, if that's your choice. But God would like to create a new creature in you. He started it off by just creating you in flesh and blood and spirit, but you're not born again. He wants to resurrect you as a new creature. You think about that. But at first there was void and there was darkness and the earth was without form. It was chaotic, my friends. There was darkness and chaos. And God brought order out of chaos. Now, the Masonic Lodge and the other occultists today say that is their goal, to bring order out of chaos. Well, they cannot do that. They will never be able to do it. Only God can bring order out of chaos. If your life is chaotic and you go from crisis to crisis, don't think that psychology or psychiatry or any man-made system can pull you out of your tailspin. They'll just put you right into the vortex of a tornado and you'll end up worse. But God took the earth, which was without form and void and dark, and he moved. He moved on that, it says, the Spirit of God. Verse 3 says, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. Friends, is there darkness in your life? God can simply say, let there be light. Let there be light. And God saw the light that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. Ah, this is the way God thinks. Why didn't it just stay dark? Why didn't he just say, I'm going to let it be all light, all dark? Now we see a personality trait of God. That's right. I'm already able to divine and discover the mind of God here in a small way. Listen to me, my friends. God has a discriminating mind. He divides. Now the whole world says, let's all come together as one. Let's be in unity. Let's end all of our divisions. Let's forget all of our petty doctrinal differences. Let us just love one another. The world says, let us have unity. But then along comes God and says, I'm going to divide. Did you know that in the last day, he says, I'm going to divide the sheep from the goats? And the Bible says that his word is like a great sword, and it cuts and it divides. Wow. Some will go to eternal damnation. Others will go to eternal bliss with Christ. He divides. And he did it right here in Genesis. He divided the light from the darkness. He began his work. And you, my friends, are either part of the light or you're part of the darkness. There's no gray area. The world likes to say, there's no absolutes. It doesn't really matter. You can be a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or a Jew or a Christian. It doesn't really matter. We all worship the same God. You see, they all try to put everything together, to bring together a synthesis. I'm not going to get into you about the Hegelian dialectic of Marxism and all of those things. But that is the same concept, to bring the two opposites together, the yin and the yang, and become one. This is the reason for the double-headed eagle of Freemasonry, their major logo, the two heads as one, on one body. But that's the way Satan works. He brings together things. Isn't that amazing? He unites things. Now, the only time Christ will unite things is when you become a new creature in Christ, then you will be one with him. But while you're in darkness, there is no way to unite. There's no way. There's no method that God has arranged for people to be united as long as they're in darkness. Number 5, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. He gave a name to the darkness and the light. And you know, he gave a name to the devil. He names things. In the New Testament, it says that it was at Antioch where those who loved Jesus were first called Christians. He gave us a name. We're a Christian. That means we're of Christ. We belong to Him. And that's the whole concept of in the beginning God. God created. And the Creator is God. And He deserves our worship. And you will never be happy, and you will always be a slave until you worship God. Remember an old song by Bob Dylan? Remember him? Because he was a reprobate in many ways, but for a short while he said he had conformed to Christianity. Then he backslid again, unfortunately. But while he was a Christian, he put out a Christian album. One of the songs was sort of interesting. He warned people, you got to serve somebody. It could be God or it could be the devil, but you got to serve somebody. The president of the United States may be president. We know he really doesn't serve the people of the United States, but I'll tell you one thing. He's ordained by God to be president, and to the extent that he serves God, he will succeed and prosper. But when he deviates from the godly path, misery comes in his life. I think that's a principle. A spiritual principle applicable to the President of the United States and every king, every potentate, every prime minister, chancellor, every CEO, every truck driver, bus driver, janitor, secretary, manager, it doesn't matter. You got to serve someone. Let's go a little further. He says, and God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. Friends, there's water in the clouds in the sky, and there's water down on earth below, and God divided it. He wanted to, and that's what he did. That's his personality. That's his mind. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. And God called the firmament heaven. Named it. That's heaven. This is earth. Because verse 10 says, and God called the dry land earth. And the gathering together of the waters called he seas, and God saw that it was good. He gathered together the waters. Listen to me, my friends. You come to know Jesus Christ as Lord. You're born again with him, John 3, verse 3. And you will be gathered by him. And you know what? Jesus is coming in the last days. 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians says that he is going to gather up the saints. Just the way he gathered together the waters and made seas. Because he is the living waters. If you're the part of that living water, you're going to be gathered up. If you're not, you're going to be dry land, my friends. You're going to be left high and dry. Now listen to this one. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good. Did you know that God divided then again? He severs, he divides, he discriminates between. Hey, some plants became herbs. Some were grass. There was fruit. And each one was of its own kind and had the seed in itself. And you know, we as human beings have the seed in ourselves. And that's why the woman from the seed produces a child. And that child should be a seed unto God. Did you hear what I just said? That child should be a seed unto God. Because a man and a woman cleaving together, becoming one, should have a seed, if they can, after his kind. We can keep going here. Verse 16 says, and God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. See, we keep dividing. Not only does he have light, but he has light for the night and light for the day. He divides and he divides and he divides and he discriminates and he severs and he separates. Does it not say in the Bible, God said, come out of them, that means the evil system of the world and the false religions. Come out, my people, and be ye separate. And I will receive you, and you will become sons and daughters of God. Listen to me. He says, come out, Be ye separate from the world. But most churches today say, I don't want to come out. I want to be part of the world. I want to be accepted. I want to conform. I want to be like everyone else. You see, the devil has always attempted to bring everybody together. But listen to me, my friends. If you're of Jesus Christ, you are different. Because you have a seed in you. God has planted in you a seed, and it will bring forth fruit after its kind. And it is different from all of the seed in the world that is of the devil. And everyone out there is producing seed of their kind. And that's why we have the wicked and the evil. But you are different. If you're the same, then you've lost your salt. You've lost everything God gave you. There's nothing of God in you. And I want you to understand something, my friends. This is so very vital to understand. If you do not understand that you are to discriminate, to separate, to sever, to divide, you're in trouble. If you don't understand that God, for example, let me go on here a little bit further. Verse 27, again, Genesis chapter 1 says, so God created man in his own image. But wait, it says in the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. He divided the man. He made the man both male and female. Not both, he separated them. There we have division. There we have separation. A lot of people say, Tex, don't you get a lot of criticism for the way you preach? Of course I do. I'm different than the rest of the world. I've separated myself from the rest of the world. Now listen to me, my friends. Here's the key. You can serve God or you can serve the devil. You can be in unity with all the peoples of the world that the devil is putting together. Remember they built the great tower at Babylon? They said, let us all be as one, and let us build a great tower into the heavens. They would be like gods, would they not? But wait, God came and he says, I'm not going to have you all be one. I'm going to separate you. I'm going to divide you. And he gave them all different languages, and they couldn't speak to each other, and they were confounded. The same principle. Did you know the devil is trying? He's got a new world order. He's bringing all the nations together. Of course he is. Everything comes together as one in the devil's plan. But God separates, and he separates the sinner from the saint. Which one are you, my friends? Now listen to me, my friends. You are going to be a slave to God, or you're going to be a slave to the devil? If you have not accepted this division, if you want to be part of the world, or if you're part of some church that says, oh, let's not preach about sin, and let's not try to think that we're better than everybody else, well, let's just all become one with the Muslims and everything, let's love each other, you are in big trouble, because God will say, okay, then fine. Go out there and you will become united with that group. You'll be in unity with them, in fellowship with the devil and his people and his works and his system. And you'll be a slave. Your soul will be stained. Friends, you're not going to have liberty. You're not going to have freedom. Let me tell you the way to freedom. The way to freedom is you accept and believe in Jesus Christ, and then he plants a seed in you and you become a new person, a new creature, and that seed begins to grow and grow in you. Now listen, God gives you liberty. The Bible says in Christ Jesus, there is liberty. But you must always do and act according as God would have you and get in line with his word. Jesus Christ said something. A lot of people don't understand it. Let me tell you what he said. He said, if thine eye be single, then thy whole body will be full of light. You know what he meant? Don't be double-minded. Be a discriminator. Yes, be divisive. Divide the good from the evil and take the good for your life. Choose between good and evil. Choose God. Get in line with him and live and be free. And throw off your chains and your shackles the devil would like to put over you. This is Tex Mars. You've been listening to Bible Home Church. May God richly bless you. Amen.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.
It's beginning to rain, 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 in the voice of our Father. Saying, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. Hello, good friends. This is Tex Mars, and I'm glad to be with you today. It's a beautiful day. We have some squirrels and some deer frolicking around, and right here in my backyard, I can just see the creation that God has created. I don't understand how people can worship the creation and not the Creator. But the New Agers and the Mother Earth advocates do so. But I see the creation as a sign of God's greatness. He created it. And how can you substitute what He created for Him? Well, it takes a little bit of ignorance to do something that silly, but some people in their great clamor to deny God do so. Glad to be with you here, and a lot of you write to us and have prayer needs, and I want to hear from you. Would you please let me know of those prayer needs? We will pray for you individually by name. So let us know of your prayer needs. I'm convinced that God will send through our prayers, God will send His holy angels to minister to you. You say, He doesn't care about me enough? Yes, He does. Yes, He does, and He answers prayers. And we have a lot of faith here. I promise you, I know He answers our prayers. Let us hear from you, okay, my friends? We'd love to hear from you and write to us. And if you're able, we'd love to have a love gift from you because we need your help. But if not, Don't send it thinking we're going to pray for you if you send us money, because we won't do that. We don't have people send us money and pay us to pray for them. We don't have that. Make sure that you or we don't want that. Make sure that you send a love gift because it's out of the desire of your heart to help God's work, and it need not have anything to do with your request for prayer. In fact, they can come in at separate envelopes. As far as I'm concerned, we're going to pray for you just as hard, but we do appreciate your gifts because we do need them. With the cost of everything going up, the cost of postage, the radio time, I don't know. You know, the White House, the president keep telling us that the cost of living is going down, but it doesn't seem like it to me and the people I talk to. And you visit the grocery store, and every time things just keep going up, up, up. I don't know where they're getting all this stuff about no inflation. No inflation, baloney. Well, I think what Paul said in the Bible is true. In the last days, men would go about deceiving and being deceived. I think that's pretty accurate in terms of a lot of our politicians today and their pronouncements about inflation and all those things. But inflation's been hitting us pretty hard here at Bible Home Church, and we appreciate your help. Now, we always have some beautiful music. We're going to have some in just a minute from Johnny Ray Watson. So many of you like the theme song, but you only hear a few little beats of it. Well, we're going to have the whole song, It's Beginning to Rain, by Johnny Ray Watson, in just a moment. I wanted to mention something to you that's come to my attention. You know, a lot of people ask me, and I always find it sort of humorous. I get one person, and they'll come up to me at a meeting, or they'll write to me or email me, and they'll say, "Dear Brother Tex, I sure hope you don't believe in that Trinity. That's just a doctrine right out of hell." And the next person will write to me and say, "Dear Tex, let me know if you believe in the Trinity. If you don't believe in the Trinity, you're right out of the pit of hell."
So I'm getting it from both sides here. And you know, the Bible doesn't talk about the Trinity. The word Trinity is not found in the Bible. But what do I believe? What do we believe here at Bible Home Church? You know, there are a lot of things the Bible doesn't teach, but nevertheless, the Bible doesn't specifically mention, but it nevertheless teaches certain things. The Bible talks about one day we shall be caught up to be with the Lord. A lot of men go around talking about a rapture. It doesn't use the word rapture, but it certainly talks about being caught up. So you can call it what you want to. But if you want to call it the great catching up, that's okay. That's be biblical according to 1 Thessalonians. But listen to this. Here is what we believe. You want to know what we believe about those things? Is God three or is God one? Well, let's just go to the Bible. I like that. I like to give people an answer from the Bible. Read with me, my friends, 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. Verse 10, it says, "He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not, God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God." You know, in Philippians it says he has a name above every other name, and that name is Jesus. Is there a Son of God? Yes, there is. Is there a God? Yes, there is a God. Is there a Holy Spirit? Absolutely. Now, I don't even use the name, the term Trinity around here. Don't try to confuse me with men's terms. I want to tell you about the Father, our God, and the Son, Jesus Christ, and about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. That's what I want to talk about. Is that the Trinity? I don't use that term in our ministry. I don't even like it. But I know one thing. There is a Father, Son, and a Holy Ghost. Don't try to convince me otherwise. Listen to verse 7. It says, "For there are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost." Now who are the three? The Father, the Word. Who is the Word? Well, John 1 says, "The Word was made flesh and dwell among us." Jesus Christ. That's the Word of God. And then there, of course, is the Holy Ghost, the Spirit. Now, friends, you can't deny it. But listen just a moment. This is the way the false teachers do it. They don't tell you the whole story. I didn't read to you the whole verse. Did you catch that when you were reading with me? Are you right now out there screaming and hollering and saying, wait, Tex, you didn't finish? If so, you're absolutely right. I tricked you. But listen to this. Listen to this. What I read to you was right. It says here, right in verse 7 of chapter 5 of 1 John, it says, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost." But wait, it goes on to say more. It says, "And these three are one." And these three are one. Are there three? Yes. Are they one? Yes. Now, what I don't really appreciate, friend, are those people that forget to give out the whole counsel of God. They'll say, "There's three in heaven. There's three." And then there's the other crowd over there that don't tell you the whole story. They say, "There's one. There's only one." Now, friends, I think you're just as much a liar if you don't tell the whole story as if you tell a fib. You are. If you don't tell the whole story, you're just as much a liar as if you just concoct a bunch of malarkey. Now listen to me very carefully. I like the whole story. There are three that bear record, and these three are one. It's a mathematical formula. Three equals one. We say that's not good math. Well, it's not to men. But who cares about men's math? God confounds the wise and uses the simple things of the world, doesn't he? His miracles to prove. Friends, listen to me. You say, I don't understand that. I don't understand how three can be one. I don't care whether you understand or not. You better ask God for more understanding. But don't doubt God because you don't understand your puny little weak mind. I can't help it because you're a simpleton. You say, now, Tex, that's not nice to call somebody a simpleton. Every person on earth is a simpleton until God reveals it to them. I put myself in that category too. If I didn't have God's help, I couldn't make heads or tails out of what this means. Take this to a college professor and say to him, an unsaved college professor, take it to an Einstein. If there one exists today, and there may be some genius-like men, and say to them, can three equal one? And they will all say, well, I don't know how. Duh. And I say, friend, you're just ignorant. You're unknowing. You don't understand. But Daniel 12, verse 10 says, the wise shall understand. The wise who are given revelation by God. You know, people who don't understand the Holy Trinity, as they call it, or that they're three or one, you know what I say to them? Maybe you're not saved. If you can't understand these things, I don't even try. And I can understand them. Had a man write to me one time, and he said, I think I've got you Christians, Tex. Explain to me, when Jesus was baptized, a dove alighted on his shoulders, which supposedly was a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And a voice was heard from heaven saying, this is my son in whom I am well pleased, that supposedly came from God. He says, now there we have three entities, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But they were not all together as one. Ha, ha, ha. An atheist wrote me that. I felt sort of sorry for the man. He doesn't understand. You know, even the newest discoveries in physics tell us that things that seem to be separated are joined, and things that seem to be joined are separated. Did you know that if you sit in front of a desk and you feel the desk and it feels like nice, hard, solid surface, metal or wood, it's not? If you could get a super electron telescope and study that, you would find out it's a mass of particles that have space between them. Just like the heavenly bodies seem to have space between them. You look into the skies and you see black space between the various planets and the stars. It's an illusion, my friend. There is stuff between them. And in the air, when you wave your hand out, you say, I can't feel anything. That doesn't mean it's not there. There are billions, trillions, quadrillions of particles in the air when you wave your hand, even as much as 6 inches, that you cannot see or feel nor hear nor even sense, but they're there. We do not understand separation or time. Who can understand that Jesus is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the earth? We say, no, he wasn't slain from the foundation of the earth. Why, he was slain in time, some 2,000 years ago. It's because you don't understand time. Even Einstein said time is relative. Einstein taught evidently what appears to be fact, although science is ever-changing in its theories. But Einstein taught that if you jump on a spacecraft or a rocket and you fly into the heavens at the incredible speed of light, you will never grow old. You will never age. Isn't that astonishing? Because time will virtually stand still for you. So you get up in the spacecraft, you travel at the speed of light, you land back on Earth. 500 years from now, you haven't aged at all, but all of your loved ones are all dead and gone. That's what he taught. And it seems to be that science is true. How can that be? That by traveling fast, you don't age. Time means nothing. It's relative. How can that be? Well, maybe we have an understanding of how God created things and how God chose you, if you're of Him, from the foundation of the world, before you were ever born, before you came out of your mother's body, way, way, way back, before Adam and Eve, God already knew you. He foreknew you. How could that be? I don't understand, you say. Well, friends, I don't care for your lack of understanding. I'm sorry. You know, as a kid, I used to look up at the skies. I was 7 or 8 years old, and I would get this strange feeling. I thought, how did it all get here? And if there is a God, how did He get here? If He created the earth, who created Him? I don't understand. I still don't understand some things. And that's why I can't wait to get to heaven. I know one thing, through faith I have accepted Jesus Christ. And that made me a lot smarter than I was just a few moments before. You know, I became so much smarter and wiser from that moment on. It's amazing what having the mind of Christ will do for a man or woman. Well, I wanted you to know what I thought about things such as the Trinity and all. I tell you what I think. I think the Bible is right. How about that? Can you dispute me on that one, my friends? Whatever you believe. You people, you come up to me and you say, do you think there's three? Yes. And the next man comes up and says, do you think there's just one? I say, yes. And they both go away thinking that I agreed with them. And I did. And I just wish they would agree with each other. They might get along a lot better. Hey, if you dispute me on this, I'd like you to turn to Romans chapter 5, verses 5 and 6. Listen to this. This is amazing. This is an amazing verse of Scripture. It says, the love of God... Now remember now, God is the Father. The love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Did you know that in those two verses, Romans chapter 5, verses 5 and 6, we have the three of the Godhead? In that little bit of passage of Scripture, you have God mentioned, you have the Holy Ghost mentioned, and you have Christ. Not only that, it says that God sheds His love. He gives His love, puts it into our hearts. How does He do it? He uses the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, in our hearts. How can He do it? Because we don't have strength in ourselves, but He did it through Jesus Christ. In due time. Now, remember I talked about time. You say, well, why doesn't He say, you know, in the year, you know, such and such. Paul just said, in due time. Hey, at God's proper time, when He thought it was the proper time, the right time, the appropriate time. Not man's time, not any particular year or date. I love those people that argue over and over. They'll say Jesus was born in 5 B.C. and some say no. 3 A.D. and some say no. It was. They argue about when Jesus was born, and some say it was in the month of December. Others say no, it was must have been April. Others say October. They fight over all these. I don't know why they fight over those things. I guess they're of some importance. You can have a lot of fun arguing over those things. But I'd just like to say, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. And who are the ungodly? I was ungodly. And in due time, Jesus died for me. Were you ungodly? You better believe it. Everybody is ungodly, undeserving. But thank the Lord, Christ died for you in due time. Well, I just want to mention to you, if you want to know about deity, about God, the Holy Ghost in Christ, go to Romans chapter 5, verses 5 and 6. And the next time somebody says, I don't understand. Here you have God's love put into your hearts by the Holy Ghost. How and why? Because in due time Christ died for your sins, because you were ungodly. All in one bit of scripture. Now that is the whole Bible in just two little verses. You know, I think we can just close up Bible Home Church today, Sandra. I mean, I've already preached the whole Bible. Isn't that amazing? It's not something because I'm so smarter. It ain't, no, not at all. In fact, you know, the more I read the Bible, the more I tell you, it bothers me tremendously. Every time I read the Bible, I realize how really much I don't know. I do. But I'm getting smarter. But you know, it's like teenagers. When they get about, you know, 18 and 21, suddenly they discover that their parents weren't so dumb after all. It's a big discovery for teenagers. I mean, up until that time, they thought their parents were not with it. Were just really dumb, old-fashioned, stodgy. And then suddenly they say, hey, old mom and dad ain't so bad after all. You know, when they get to be an adult themselves and they say, you know, the world is what it is and, you know, you get so much smarter. It's like I had a friend. Oh, and he battled with me all the time. He just thought abortion was a great thing and was helpful to women and that homosexuals should have their rights. And, oh, you know, they'd been so wronged. And, oh, he had all these liberal ideas and everything. Then he came to know Jesus and, you know, he just changed overnight. The man suddenly had new revelations. All those months I argued and I argued and I argued with the man. You know, that taught me something. You can't argue with a sinner. You just argue till you're blue in the face. But bring them Jesus Christ, and the Holy Ghost will instruct them in all things. He'll teach them everything they need to know. Pretty soon they'll be teaching you if they read the Bible enough, and you don't, and you'll be embarrassed. You'll be ashamed. And that's true. You know, most new baby Christians, they have to teach the older Christians that have gotten jaded and backslid, no longer read the Bible. It takes the baby Christians to teach the older Christians. That's sort of a shame. Well, right now we're going to have a beautiful song by Johnny Ray Watson. It's called It's Beginning to Rain. Here's Johnny Ray.
The turtle dove is singing the sweet songs of the morning. The leaves of the trees send the silvery cups to the sky. The silent clouds above are beginning to gather. The barren land is so thirsty and so am I. It's beginning to rain, rain, rain. Hear the voice of our Father. Sing, whosoever will come drink of this water. I promise to pour my spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky, it's beginning to rain.
Beginning to rain.
The young man's eyes start to shine as he tells of his vision. The old understands what he sees, for they dream their dreams with the thrill of being alive. They reach for each other and they dance in the rain for the joy of the things they see. It's beginning to rain, rain, rain. Hear the voice of our Father. Sing, whosoever will come drink of this water. I promise to pour my spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky, it's beginning to rain. At the first drop of rain that you feel, open your window.
Then call all the children together, throw wide the door. When the rain of the Spirit are falling, fill every vessel. For he who drinks his fill will thirst no more. It's beginning to rain, 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 in the voice of our Father. Saying, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty, dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning to rain. If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky, it's beginning to rain.
We hope this week's program has been a blessing to you. Please tune in to Bible Home Church next week.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.